Well, it's my great honor and pleasure to be able to introduce Pam Cox Otto. I've had the pleasure of actually being a part of one of her workshops before. It was an amazing thing for me, and it actually altered my way of thinking about diversity and equity in the community colleges around communicational differences, about generational differences, about how people like to communicate with each other, and it was a very fantastic experience. So you are the CEO of Interact Communications, and Dr. Pamela Cox Otto is a part of our Breaking Barriers lecture series, as you know.
What I want to talk about today is generational differences, and they really are huge whether or not you're aware of it. How many people here are between the ages of 18 and 35? I see, yes. Okay, good number of you. You are Gen Y, and you probably look at your parents and go, I don't get you. How can I come from you? We have so little in common. And if you are between the ages of 35 and 54, you look at both the boomers older than you and the Xers who are younger than, the Yers that are younger than you, and you think to yourself, who are you people? What planet are you from? And if you're a boomer, let's be honest, who's a boomer? Older than 55, but not quite dead. Okay, if you are a boomer, then the issue is this. You look around and you go, I give and I give and I give, and you people just don't appreciate me. Sound familiar? So we're going to talk about generational differences, and I'm going to go quickly, mostly because I can't help myself. I'm a born and raised Californian, and I talk fast. And when I live in Wisconsin, I have to tell you, they look at me and they go like, slow down, you're scared. Actually, they don't. They do this. They do, Pam, slow down, you're scaring us. It's a little nasally, it's not quite Canada, but it's not Minnesota either, okay? We're gonna talk about generational differences. I'm gonna start with the Beloit College, and yes, Beloit College is a small private school in Wisconsin, but what they do is every year they survey their incoming freshmen and they say, what is different about this group? What do they know about the world that other groups don't know or forgot? Ready? So first of all, Andre the Giant, River Phoenix, Princess Diana, Cousteau, and Mother Teresa have always been dead. The minute they were born, these people were gone. They have no relevance to your life, right? Except, come on, hasn't anybody seen The Princess Bride? Remember Andre the Giant? No. I once interviewed Andre. We were standing in a two-shot, right, on the camera, and I'm standing there, and the camera slowly pulls out, and we're talking face-to-face, and as the camera pulls out about 10 feet, you realize the entire time that I've been interviewing him, he's had his hands under my armpit, and I'm dangling about 3 feet off the floor. It was a great moment for me. They were in kindergarten when they saw the planes fly into WTC, so this is the class coming up of 2019. Again and again, The Daily Show was their trusted news source. Cell phones are so common in class that teachers can't tell if you're planning a party or taking notes. You sit there and you go, no, I was really, I'm taking notes, honest. They never licked a postage stamp, and in fact, it's very rare that they ever send anything snail mail. The post office is tick, 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 almost dead. Bill Gates has always been the richest man in the world. Everybody has always loved Raymond. Madonna has always been freaking old and never hot. Let's be honest, never hot. And the announcement of being the first woman to do something doesn't mean a freaking thing. Nothing. All that brouhaha in the recent election about how young Gen Y women don't care about Hillary, right? They don't care. Let's be honest, most of the community doesn't care that at this point, Bernie Sanders is the first Jewish man to ever win an election of one of the primary votes, right? A whole state. It's the first time. Does anybody care? No. Why? They're so over that stuff. In our worlds, understanding generations are critical. For example, I see many of you are students. You have that look, that glazed look that says I'm getting extra credit for being here. And so please make this funny because I am freaking suffering. So you're a student. And you've been asked to come here by somebody to take notes to something you should be listening to. Have you ever listened to your faculty and you go, I don't get it. Why are they making me do this, Kaka? This doesn't matter to my life. Why are they making me study this, right? And I assure you, at the same time, those faculty members are looking at you and going, why don't you care? Why don't you love this stuff? That, my friends, is the generational breakdown that we're seeing. And we're seeing the breakdown continue because in this upcoming election, it's going to be one of the most interesting showdowns in the world. It's going to prove whether or not Gen Y will show up to the marketplace and will come in and vote in large numbers. That generation matters. And you know why it matters? If you are between 17 and 30 years old, you just this year took over being the largest generation in America. Yes, baby boomers like myself are dying off at amazing rates, making room for you to lead the way. In other words, if Gen Y as a group voted for what you wanted,
like don't make me pay for college,
and
I'd like a job that pays me more than, oh, let me think, Walmart.
If you went out and asked for that, and you voted as a block, you could rule America. Which means it's time to stop playing the video game and go vote. Otherwise, we're going to charge you up the yin-yang for your education. It's all shifting. Boomers are tired and cranky. Xers are kind of happy. Yers kind of like their parents' basement. And Zers, that's the generation younger than 17, is almost here. Now, there's a big debate. Some people think actually Gen Z, if you're 18, anybody in here about 18, 19, you could be a Gen Zer. But we'd have to dissect you, and we don't have time. It would be ugly. So we won't. So we think maybe the shift happened maybe a few years early, but we know for a fact that in about 3 years, Gen Z will be here and they will be different. So look at who's we're talking about. Traditionalists older than age 71, for the most part, they're a very small generation, not because they weren't big in the first place, but because they're dying out in huge numbers. Baby boomers, 52 to 70, there's 76 million of them. Xers, 36 to 51, there's only 66 million of them. And Gen Y, 35 to 16, there's only 76 million of them. But if you'll notice that point two, that point, am I standing? Here we go. No, it's not going to show. The point two difference is you will wipe that out this year. You may wonder why there's more Gen Yers coming into the world. It's because for the most part, all of the new people who come here as coming to basically as immigrants are in that Gen Y group. Baby boomers, these are the groups I'm going to talk about. Boomers, Xers, and Yers. And the reason is quite simply, these are the groups that you find in colleges for the most part. Senior management tend to be boomers. Middle management tend to be Xers. And students tend to be Yers. That's the group. You are both the traditional and the non-traditional group. Am I talking too loud or too fast? Are you okay with me? Oh, look, even the students nodded. I like that when I get just a moment of, I felt something special, you know. Here we go. So, simply put, we see the world differently. If you're over 40, that's John Lennon. If you're under 40, well, that's Harry Potter. Yes, I know, you're going, I don't like Harry Potter. I never did. Boomer, or I'm alive, but not retired, darn it. I find that it's really hard to explain what shaped boomers. And the reason why, if you're a Yer or an Xer, you care, is because these people have power in your life. Stay with me. If you are a student, I will teach you how to roll your baby boomer teacher. I will teach you how to roll your baby boomer parents or your baby boomer grandparents, but you have to focus, so stay with me. The first thing that I've discovered is that I believe that there's almost nothing that can't be explained by video, right? So I'm trying to explain to you what shaped baby boomers and made them who they are, and the best way is to show you, well, kind of what they were all about. Very low. Can we turn that up a little bit? No?
Try to take one. because people have got to know whether or not their president's a crook. Well, I'm not a crook.
Excuse me, why the Christmas come? If you want to go where the war is, this is the way.
What are you supposed to do when you see the facts?
If you're a wire, that all looks like ancient history. But if you're a boomer, you're looking at that going, Lassie, I loved Lassie. And Timmy fell down the well again. Why didn't anybody ever tell Timmy not to go in the well? Why didn't anybody ever warn them? I know you're looking at that going, I don't get that. That's not that funny. But trust me, there's things that you know about that we go, I don't know. I don't understand. These are our inside jokes. Boomers are basically 52 to 70. They are senior management staff. They are older returning students, many of them. There's a lot of things about boomers where they said, someday when I retire, I'm going to go back to school and learn how to do blah. And it could be underwater basket weaving. It could be woodworking. It could be I want to learn to speak another language. All of those things. Kind of hard to say. But the bottom line is that they are the parents. If you are a Gen Yer, about 52% of you have parents who are in this age group. And if you're a Gen Xer, all of you have parents in this age group. These are your parents to a large extent. What shaped them were some of the things I was showing you. The Vietnam War, civil rights, the draft was up, and the people that got drafted into Vietnam were by large part people who were not in college, and that war was one of the most interesting unfair wars ever fought because of the fact that one of the things that happened was huge numbers of the Latino and African American communities were sent to war because they did not have somebody paying their way into college to get them a pass. So Vietnam became this kind of watermark of both a really unfair war fought over things that for the most part we didn't think were fair to begin with. But more than that, it took a disproportionate number of our what was then called minority, we would consider diverse communities, into the battlefield. The civil rights and women's rights movements, those were big freaking deals. And the whole idea is that for the most part, educated boomers are all about making sure that the world is fair for folks. Unfortunately, not everybody got educated. So you've got a huge number of uneducated boomers, many of whom I believe are following Trump right at this moment. And they believe, did I say that out loud? I'm sorry, my political biases are beginning to show. They are out there and they're saying, oh, I'm scared of what's coming next. Let's make sure that we get somebody in there who believes what I believe, truth and stuff. Mostly stuff. Television shaped us, and the rebel mentality. I know we look old and chubby to you, but in our heads, we are like so rocking the rebel thing. I know, you're looking, you're going, yeah, you're old and you're fat, and you haven't done anything cool in years. I can see that in your eyes. The world is not a safe place, is what told us, right? You could grow up, you could go to other countries, but at the end of the day, you're not safe out there in the wilder world. The original boomer, the boomer that went through World War II, that was born right afterwards, in a sense, they were driven to struggle and make a difference. And in fact, guys, if you have parents or faculty who are, in fact, boomers, here's the single set of words that you can say to them to make them do anything you want. You ready? Mom, Dad, Professor blah, 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 I can't tell you what a difference you've made to my life. We eat up that whole you made a difference thing like nobody's business. Tell us you were never planning to study this, but now you've made a difference. I'm studying it. Tell us that we matter, and we will, like, suck up so much. It's so sad to see, really. It's kind of a sad thing. The big thing is that they're kind of making the waiting generations wait too long. And by the way, you'll notice that Gen Z, who comes right after this group, they're like, They're 50. They thought they would be like in charge by now, but the freaking boomers won't leave. And the reason why the freaking boomers won't leave is because we had the big downturn, the big great recession, and all of everybody's stocks and stuff suddenly all went to hell in a handbasket, and they didn't have enough money to retire, so they stayed in their place, right? But what that meant is there wasn't new jobs coming up. There aren't places for all the Gen Xers to move into. And for the most part, if you look at presidents across the country of colleges, they're almost all boomers. Why? Because they haven't retired yet. Now, that will change shortly, but for the most part, you've got a whole generation of Gen Xers who are sitting there going, always the bridesmaid, never the bride. I never get to be the really cool one. However, as they've gotten older, the boomers have become tired and, dare I say it, just a little scared. They mourn for their loss of choices, like, I thought I'd retire with enough money to move to Tuscany. Work, I thought I'd be able to retire without ever actually having to use a computer. I hate that. And doing online learning, I can't believe they made me do it. And play, do you know how much I want to ski when I go up to the mountains? And I know, I used to be a ski patrolman, I know that I'm just another chubby old woman waiting to break my leg going down that hill, so I can't do it. All those things I thought I would be doing at my age, I don't dare do because I will kill myself. They yearn for connections and belonging as never before, and here's the problem. Boomers have been so busy building things, doing things. For the most part, we've not been good at maintaining relationships. I went back to my 40th year high school reunion. I hadn't seen those people in 40 years. Between you and me, they're old and fat, and many have no hair. It was a very sad thing to see. And then I realized, oh, wait. It was a moment. I had not stayed in touch with any of them. They hadn't stayed in touch with us. There's a certain disconnect in boomers because we kind of were moving along. Do they want to have it all? No. At this point, they want the right things. They don't want to have everything. They just want things that match their lifestyle. And if you have parents who are boomers, here's the warning for you. You're about to experience what I call the Great Purge. You know what the Great Purge is? The Great Purge is that your mom and dad suddenly go through the basement or the attic and they go, I don't need all this shit. And they say, would you like this? Would you like that? Would you like this? How about that? If you haven't had it happen yet, you will. Remember these words in honor of Nancy Reagan. Just say no when they try to give you all that stuff. Some things never change. This is, if you are an Xer, if you are a Yer, and you wonder why boomers get cranky at you and start giving you kind of the evil eye, not offering to help makes them really, really cranky. And they are the last of that whole 8-to-5 group. I have my own company. I have about 20 folks who work for me, right? I have only one other person in the company who's a boomer, and he's the guy who's sitting there by the door going, you going home now? What? But it's only 4:45, you know? Or the person that comes in at 8:15, they go, oh, did you have something going on before you got here? Why are you? I tell him, stop it. They don't like you. They're going to poison your food, but they don't listen to me. He doesn't listen. But boomers tend to do that. So if you have a job where you're working with boomers, they're the person that you show up 5 minutes late, and they're going to be going, so how am I going to get those 5 minutes back? Right? Sound familiar? Well, this is kind of what makes them jerks. I'm just saying. This is the last generation that believes that, however. Now, I told you that I believe that the world is a better place when you can talk about things using commercials. So what I've done is I put together commercials that I think explain the boomer psyche better than I could ever explain it in a million years. So you ready? First of all, boomers want to pass on the experiences that they've had, even when you don't freaking want to hear them.
This one, I got in Belize. I was naked. Ziplining with a man.
No,
we're fine, honey. This is good. This is great. I'm teaching her.
This is what you let your mom
write. Yes, I have discussed it. Can you really talk to Katniss?
Of course.
Some things are worth holding on to.
You're hugging the tree.
That's why we got a Subaru.
Wasn't that tree?
Introducing the all-new Subaru Outback. Love, it's what makes a Subaru a Subaru.
I think I've actually had that moment. Was it here? No, maybe it was over there. And they don't want to be reminded that we're not as cool as we think we once were. That we've still got it.
This is Paul. He's been a chorus, Beatle, Wayne, poet, father, frontman, producer, business mogul, painter, and if that weren't enough, a knight. The key is never stop doing what you love. Call us today. We'll help you plan for the next part of your life. Fidelity Investments. Smart move.
See, he's been all those things. And in our minds, we've been all those things too. We've been special. But of all the things we want, we would like a little pizzazz at work. Because to be honest, it's a little boring sometimes.
Flight 152 is now boarding to Honolulu.
Check, check, check. Business class.
Boarding, man.
Safety check.
This, get here, and we're out of here.
All right, let's get the show on the road, boys.
Buckle up, dudes.
Get work done now with new rugged Nextel Direct Connect phones for $69.99, only on the Now Network.
So every time a boomer tries some new thing to kind of get you excited about what you're learning, this is what they're doing in their heads. They're making this fun. I know, you're thinking, torture, freaking torture. But they think, fun. I'm making this fun. Their expectations, well, service. And this is important to you guys because if you are trying to make boomers happy, these are the things they're looking for. Violate my expectations and I will get verbal. I'll get in your face. I expect you to do A and B and C. And if you don't do that, I won't go quietly away. I will like, why are you doing that? Have you had your parents do that to you one day when I thought you'd be home at 9? They also believe that if you violate them repeatedly, I will go away. I will walk away. You'll be sorry. You'll be sorry when I'm dead. Yes, you will. And in terms of the classroom, the teacher, they want, if you're an administrator, faculty in this area want their choice of time, place, and medium. Because for the most part, when you do kind of distance education, they miss the kind of emotional connection that you get with people. And the reason why they taught is because they want to see your eyes. They want to see them when they half clothes and sleep, and when they wake up, they want to see both of those things. And show me you care about my stuff. You want to raise your grade by a half a point by doing nothing more than doing a little bit of excitement? Do this. Do this. When a boomer's talking about their class and their stuff, do this. Or whatever passes for looking really freaking interested, right? Just kind of lean forward. In fact, if you don't want to make that face, just lean forward a little bit. We'll take it from there. Show interest. They will love you. If you're a student, make it brief, make it punchy, make it practical. They want to hear the details. They want practicality at this point in their lives. How do they want? Well, face-to-face is preferred. And if you are a middle manager somewhere who's working with a lot of boomers, you will find that boomers will always tell you to come down to their office. If you're a student, they'll say, why don't you come into my office? And you're like, I've got you on the freaking phone now. Why can't you just talk to me? Or, we're texting, isn't that enough? No, they want to see you. They want to see your little eyes. It's the most annoying thing about boomers ever. The phone is okay, but they prefer face-to-face. We use the others, but we don't really get what we need from them. And we like Facebook. We think Facebook is kind of cool. We're a little sad you've all been leaving. Was it something we said? Should we have showered? What was it that made you want to suddenly? Gen Y suddenly began to leave. The minute boomers began to arrive, wires started to go. It was so sad. We only came because you were there. The message, they still like ideals. They dream the big dream. For a boomer, the idea that we should all be in a place where we get along together, where the world is fair, where there is a certain amount of plenty for everyone, that's a dream. That's something that we would absolutely love. However, at this point in their life, they're looking to make a legacy. They want to leave something behind. Somebody who's a faculty member here, they want to believe that when they leave here, people are going to miss them, that they're going to be, remember them? They taught that so well. It was great. They believe technology augments the old ways, but they'd really prefer, to this day, I still prefer to take notes on paper. I hate doing it on a computer, even though I know the computer is a better thing, and I'm not afraid of computers. They like to balance the new things with the way old things were, and in their mind, everything old will someday be new again. Here's the takeaway. You want to roll a boomer? All you have to do is tell them they've still got it. Respect, teaching, they understand the world. You're not losing it. No. Boy, I'm so glad you're here to teach me this stuff. And leverage that into the whole idea that, you know, when I graduate from here, I'm going to tell others how good you are. That's your legacy. I'm your legacy. Now, some of you are sitting there thinking, I can't say that with a straight face. Work on it. Go into the bathroom. Practice it. God, I'm glad you're here. And a little bit of surprise, too. I've learned so much from you. I am so lucky to have you as a teacher. Now, those of you who are boomers and teachers, forget what I just said. Let's talk about Gen X. How many folks are in the Gen X generation? Meaning 35 to about, okay, I see a few. One, two. Okay, a few that are admitting it. Okay. You are kind of the Swiss cheese, you know, you're the cheddar cheese in the sandwich. You have this big old hunkin' generation above you, boomers, and you've got this huge generation below you, all the wires, and you're in the middle going, when am I ever going to be able to have power? You're like, why won't those boomers leave? And by the time they leave, there'll be wires coming up behind me, right, taking those damn jobs. And let's be honest, Xers are just a little cranky about that fact. Just a teensy bit cranky. Let's talk about what the original Gen Xer was, and as before, I will show you in a series of snippets.
Bueller.
They forgot my birthday.
Don't you.
Chernobyl nuclear reactor.
I'll be back.
The question isn't what are we going to do, the question is what aren't we going to do.
Being bad feels pretty good.
You must have been thinking of, why doesn't he tell us what's happening?
I have absolutely no recollection.
Gen X is basically 36 to 51. They're senior and middle management and staff. They are the children of boomers, mostly. So they, you know, if you're an Xer and you're still fighting with your parents, I've just given you the keys to the kingdom. This is how you get back into the will. And they're the parents of Gen Y partly. About 48% of Gen Y, these are your parents. The other group, they're all boomers. And actually, I shouldn't mention it. For those of you who are the children of boomers, for the most part, you were second families. Mainly because boomers went like, I love you, but I'm not in love with you anymore. And they broke up families, and it was the first generation to really divorce in large numbers and then start a second family, which is why you have this kind of split piece, right? So what shaped them were things like Chernobyl, which is the big nuclear meltdown plant, right? That whole idea that at any given moment things could explode and we could all be glowing red and yellow and green. Lockerbie, the idea that travel on planes isn't safe. And 9/11 also kicked that up. But Lockerbie was the first time that you had a major airline go down because of bombs planted underneath. And suddenly, going to Europe didn't look nearly as much fun as it used to. Things like cable and digital and fax and pagers and Palm Pilots. When my daughter was born, and she's a Gen Yer, everybody thought I was the coolest person ever. You know why? because I had a fax machine at home. And when I was at home taking care of the baby, I also would fax in things. Was I like really lame or what? Their whole thing is that my family is not safe. These are the children of divorce. For the most part, their parents didn't stay together. So the parents divorce, and they grow up in one of the mixed families where you're here with mom and dad on the weekends, but you're over here with a second mother and dad on the weekends, or there was just a lot of breakup, right? And this is the generation who boomers didn't come to their games. They didn't come to their performances. Why? Because boomers were out saving the freaking world, right? So because of that, this grew up going, my family, who should love me more than anybody else in the world, isn't freaking here. That's that whole thing where she goes, they forgot my birthday. This group feels like the boomers forgot their birthday. And so they grew up saying, I don't like you. I'm not going to be like you. I'm not going to care about your shit. And so what they did was they grew up and they put all of their attention, for the most part, on family. They became the soccer moms. They became the dads that would take time out and work from home. They began to focus on family almost entirely, right? It's the first generation where they would stay home. They are, in fact, the original latchkey children, right? This is the group where they'd go, mommy can't be home until 9 o'clock, but there's a casserole in the refrigerator. Turn on the oven to 375, warm up your own freaking dinner, and put yourself to bed after you do your homework. I'm sure you'll handle it all just fine, right? So this group grew up looking at boomers and going, whatever the freaking happens, I'm never going to be like them. Never going to be like them. I'm not going to put the world before my family. I'm not going to put the world before me. So this generation basically said, I don't believe anybody here is going to take care of me except me. So I'm going to make sure that I get taken care of because I can't count on any of you. My own parents wouldn't take care of me. This is the group that practices extreme independence. They love learning skills. But if you expect them to stay late and work, it's a deal breaker. I told you, I only have one other boomer in my office, right? He's the idiot who comes in exactly at 7:55 and leaves at 5, right? Everybody else kind of blows in about 8:15, 8:30. By around 3:45, people start disappearing because I've got a football game, my daughter's doing something, I'm volunteering at whatever, but I'm with my family, and I'm leaving. I'm not going to be here sticking this out. Why? Because one of the things that happened to this generation is that they saw boomers work all their lives at these places and get laid off by these big freaking corporations who said, thank you for your 30 years, now don't let the door hit you in the ass on the way out. I was teaching at the University of Minnesota, right? And I had one of those huge classes, like 300 people. And I walk in and it's kind of empty. People haven't shown up yet. And there's a woman down in front and she's sobbing. Older woman, maybe, you know, 50-ish, sobbing in my class. And I go, what's wrong? Why are you crying? And she said, I work for Northwest Airlines. I am 3 days from having my retirement vest so that I get retirement benefits. And guess what happened? They laid her off 3 days before she would get anything from retirement. They freaking raped her financially. Corporations do that all the time. They don't feel any great love of anybody. And this group said, okay, I get it. You don't love me, I won't love you. I will not wait for you. Their big thing is you've messed with their personal life, they are done. They are done. You expect them to put in the hours where they can't be with their family, when their children need them, when their spouse needs them, and they will walk out. Those of you who have parents like this, you had them come to your soccer games. You had them show up when you were in a play. Why? Because that mattered to them, and they weren't going to let you down the way they feel boomers let them down. So you are where their values are. The tested Gen Xer, and by the way, when these kids were young, we used to sit around going, they're slackers, you know. We watch them all the time. They don't work hard like us boomers. They are such lazy slackers. I can't believe that. So we would say to them, okay, you know, you're a slacker. We'll wait for the next generation to come along. But guess what? This is the generation that during 9/11, these are the people who walked into the building to pull people out. These are the people who on the plane, when God knows where it was flying, decided that they would try to take it over and crash it in a place where it wouldn't hurt others. They are gutsy. And they are willing to put others first when they know that it really matters. they bounced back, and one of the most interesting things that happened after 9/11, and I know that's a while ago for most of you, but after 9/11, right, this is the generation who, when boomers were saying, you know, free speech, you should be able to talk about the fact that we don't want to go to war in Afghanistan, we should be able to talk about all these things, this is the group that said, hell with talk, shut up, put up or shut up, it's our country, right or wrong, they attacked us. No, just no. This is the generation that said bounce back is very, very patriotic, red, white, and blue. They are tired, however, of being what I've called the sandwich generation, meaning boomers, if you're here, if you could possibly retire very soon, they would really, really, really appreciate it because they are ready to take control. And their fear is that, of course, you won't leave until all the wires are behind them and they will be pushed out of the way. That's their biggest fear. Some things never change about them, and one of them is don't make me suffer a fool or whoever I think is one. Basically, they don't have a lot of patience with people that they think are like, you know, loser. By the way, I have to do this. Ready? Loser. World-class loser. Varsity loser. You lettered in loserness. And my husband came up with this one day. You ready? We always say goodbye. I love you. I love you. I love, oh, wait. Universal loser. One size fits all. Just saying. They also say, I'll work hard, but on my own terms. This group, I now have probably half a dozen people who are Xers working for me. The big thing that I have to do if I want to keep them is flexibility. They will work very hard, but they will work around their family issues, right? They want to make time out in the middle of the day to be there when they're supposed to bring cookies to their kids' plays. They'll do all of that work, but they want to make sure that they don't drop the ball with their family. So of all of the groups, flexibility is a really big one for this. They have no patience for people who don't understand who they are and don't get their old generation.
You guys hungry?
They go so fast.
I know they do, don't they?
Why is Carol sitting all the way over there?
Carol almost told Evan that there are vegetables in the Chef Boyardee.
Nearly ruined their favorite after-school snack.
So she's in a timeout. I hope she learns from this. Chef Boyardee microbeef ravioli microwave cups, an after-school snack with a full serving of vegetables. Just don't tell them.
And they want it the way they want it.
Your contact lenses that I ordered just arrived.
1-800-CONTACTS. They can't possibly have my brand. It's a special brand. I have special eyes.
They have so many brands in a giant warehouse in Utah, and real humans check each order.
That's shiny.
Look with your special eyes.
My brand. I'm such a fool. Quality contact lenses. 1-800-CONTACTS. We're that passionate about eyes. Call, click, and help more.
If you're a wire, you think that's the most lame thing you've ever seen in your life. And they would like you to help them, but here's the thing about them. They don't really think you're going to help them at all. They think we are cats. They call for help. We do nothing. We watch them sink. However, they will do whatever it takes to get their own way.
You don't finish your peas when I go to Baskin Robbins for Oreo Sundays.
Oreo Steaks and Sundays. It's Oreo Explosion at Baskin Robbins.
And direct from the Super Bowl, they are happiest when doing their thing with their family.
Yeah.
hard to resist great taste. Meet the Ketchups.
Come on. Who doesn't like ketchup and mustard and little dogs in hot dog suits? Come on, I want to be a part of that. Their expectations? Well, their service expectations are processes that understand they have other priorities, meaning a lot of people tried to set up programs to pull these people back to college, and they failed. And they failed because they would expect you to be there, you know, 8 to 2 in a more normal class. And this group isn't going to do that. They have work, they have jobs, and of all the things they want, it's family time. They also don't make me come talk to you face to face. This group hates that. It's like they hate talking to boomers because we always say, come by my office, and they go, we're on the phone. Can't we just talk now? And they say, no, I need to see you. No, you don't. You really, really don't. Violate my expectations and I will take my marbles and go. This group, if they have a bad day at the office, by the end of the day, they are up on monster.com looking for the next job with people that they will like better than you. It's true. Their classroom expectations are streamlined. No frills is okay as long as it's fast. Give it to me. Give it to me quickly. Pragmatism, make it useful tomorrow. I teach at a program where I teach master's level students, right? And I want to explain the theory about why, under the, you know, the old thing about give a man a fish, he'll eat for a day, teach him how to fish, and they'll eat for a lifetime, right? I'm trying to teach them the theory underneath what I'm teaching them. And they were like, I don't give a shit. They said that actually out loud, or is that just me? They say, I don't care. What I really want is I want folks to give me the thing I need right now. I'll learn how to fish later. Just give me the freaking fish. They are very pragmatic about that. And they think cohorts are okay, but group projects are bad. This is a group that does not like to work with others. Not because they don't like other people, but simply because if I have to arrange your schedule to meet with your schedule to meet with your schedule, we're all gonna lose way too much time. Can't we just like text each other, email each other? It would be fine. The thing that they like is the phone. Because it doesn't mean I don't have to go over and see you. They like the phone a lot. Email is okay, except it takes so freaking long to write the email, and drama. This group hates drama, which means they don't like boomers a lot, because boomers, we love drama. How do you feel? How does that make you feel? What's going on in your head? Face-to-face takes so much time, and they are not fans. The message, they want authentic with warts. Tell me the freaking truth. Tell me that. I don't care if it's something I don't want to hear, but tell me what it works. So if you have faculty who are like this, right, do not tell them your grandmother died. Do not tell them your puppy was hit by a car, which is why use those on the boomers. We love those. No, what you say to them is, I meant to do it, and I freaking blew it off. Yeah, I'm sorry. I will change it now. They would rather have you do I freaking blew it off and tell them the truth than give them the long dead puppy grandmother story. They like concrete words, proof, outcomes. Children come first. And basically, they're one of the most black and white generations to come along in a long time. Meaning, you're with me or you're against me. You're helping me or you're not. And if you're not, you know, this is the group that if you're failing a class, they'll look at you and go, wow, you're failing. Sucks to be you. Boomers, we go, oh, you're failing. Well, what have I done wrong that you're not learning this stuff that I love? Xers just go, you didn't care. So? Come back when you do. They are realistic. Their goal, I'm never going to be a sap. I'm not going to be a sap, particularly not like my parents. How to talk to an Xer? Well, you talk about family, work, if it's meaningful work, maintaining freedom, flexibility, friendship, community. These folks do not travel in groups of friends. What they say is, it's enough that I have a good life, that I'm doing okay, that my family is good, and I'm done. That's how you talk to them. So wires, and that's you sitting here who are between the ages of 17 and 35. This is you in a nutshell.
Within seconds, Challenger disintegrates.
Our controllers here looking very carefully at the situation. Be a major malfunction.
I just saw another plane.
Another plane has just hit.
There's another one.
Another explosion.
Oh, wow.
Oh no.
We
We just saw another one.
Child spoken.
Duffy, you are the slayer.
You're a wizard, Harry.
I'm a what?
Guns.
From my cold, dead hands.
Lots of guns.
The deadliest campus shooting spree in U.S. history. A gunman killed at least 30 people at Virginia Tech University.
Whoa.
I'm so scared.
Human beings are a disease. You are a cancer of this planet.
Temperature increases are taking place all over the world, and that's causing stronger storms.
Early this morning, Hurricane Katrina slammed into New Orleans.
If the apocalypse comes, beat me.
Gen Y? Well, 17 to 35, all levels of employment. Traditional and returning age college students, the youngest of them are in college right now or coming into college. This is the generation that is the new billionaire. They're the ones who came up with something that Xers and boomers never thought, like Facebook, like most of the new startups, and went, wow, I could make money doing this, and did so. What shaped them is a whole bunch of things that are scary to think about. Campus shootings, Columbine, Virginia Tech, Illinois, 9/11 and unending wars in their lifetime. Boomers, we had Vietnam, but at least it kind of came and it went, right? There has never been a time we've been out of a war in most of their lives. The internet and games, lots of games, games on your phone, games in your computer, games every place, and the return of the Wild Wild West, where somehow or another America thinks that if we don't all have freaking guns, we aren't safe. Like that little baby that was shot the other day because there was a gun in their home. You know what? If other people had been armed in that house, they could have shot the gun out of her hand. If only we'd all had guns. That would have been a really good solution. This whole idea is that I'm not personally safe. So what that has done and engendered this sense of, this is a scary freaking world. Yeah, boomers, we knew that we could get into a nuclear war, but we're taught that we could crawl under our desks and we would be safe. I know that sounds stupid. They told us that. If you see the flash, crawl under your desk. I know, crazy. But the nice thing about it was, at least I was safe in my own home. You're not safe in your school. You're not safe at the mall. Your danger was always over there, right? Now danger is here, and it gets worse all of the time. Your social group or your herd is everything, and you're the first generation that has really latched on to your referent group in a way that's really meaningful. Boomers, we grew up, we had friends, but we left them behind. Maybe we made new ones as we went along, but we didn't keep them. Xers, we were always about us anyway. Me, I can depend on me. But Yers, you said, you know what? If I have a good group of friends, I can stick together. We will protect each other. So you guys do things like, you know, go on dates with each other. Five or six of you on a date, on a party. You are the first group that actually was told you could study together and do group projects. You like working together. You like using the phone. You like staying in touch. That kind of idea that you are a herd is a good thing. Your big thing is flexibility. You want to work, you want to do things, but you also want to make time for your friends, and you don't really need things all neat and clean and stuff. Disorganization is fine. In fact, it's a good thing. Out of a certain amount of that comes fun stuff. Teams are awesome, but let's text next time. In the meantime, my parents' basement is great. This group, for the most part, we were very surprised, Xers too, you actually, for the most part, 8 out of 10, like your parents. That was a nice change for us, because Xers didn't like us. They went like, I can't believe you, boy, you never came to my parties, I don't love you, right? So you came up and you went to your Xer parents, we're okay with you, we think you're kind of cool. And you were okay with your boomer parents too, but that's because we got a little better as we got older. We suddenly realized we'd screwed up on our first family. So, they have paid a price for education like no other generation has. And here's what I mean by that. I am a graduate of Humboldt State University, you know, way up north, right? Okay. My entire college degree cost $2,000, and that includes books, right? So the next time you hear some lousy boomer saying, I paid for my education, you can pay for yours, remind them that that was a time when the government underwrote 9/10 of the cost of going to school, right? So when you hear somebody saying, well, you know, it's important that you learn to pay your own way, what a flaming freaking lie that is. What happened is government began to underfund education. Schools, in order to keep them open, raised the cost, and then the bill got passed to you, so you're graduating in debt. Worse, you know what? I don't give a crap about the American debt load. I care about your debt load. I care about your debt load. You ought to be able to get through college and make your life better without having to risk your entire future, and we have done that to you. Please, show up this fall and vote our freaking asses out. I will thank you for it. The Awakening Gen Yer, and by the way, remember I said in the beginning this is who they were? You're beginning to kind of wake up. 50% of you go to college, but you arrive with what faculty call memory chip issues, writing and critical thinking. And that's not your fault. What it really is that we also underfunded all the high schools too. And instead of teaching you good skills that would help you do things that you need to do, we made you practice for freaking tests. So you're really pretty damn good at the freaking tests, but you're not good at the stuff that will actually help you get a job and do well in these things. And once again, that's on our ass, and you should vote us out. Women are educationally active. You will find that most schools in America are 60 to 65% women, and the remainder, right, 35% are men. For the most part, women have opted in. Fellas have opted out. This is the biggest generation to reject religion that has ever come down the pike. 5 years ago, that wasn't true. 5 years ago, Y was a generation that was kind of, you know, buying into what their parents were saying, etc. But in the last 5 years, they've gone from being believers to the group that has the least amount of faith in religion, to a large extent because your generation is one of the most accepting of religious differences that has ever come down the line, and they see that the differences of religion at that adult parent level are not doing anything but adding a lot of freaking chaos to our world. So it doesn't mean that they don't believe in higher powers, but it means we're certainly not going to go buy into that. I should hate you because you are Jewish or Muslim or evangelist, whatever, right? So they're not, their whole piece is not to buy into that. They are hungry for worthy leaders. They are The biggest thing that's happening right now is how young Gen Y are showing up en masse to vote for Bernie Sanders. One, because he is telling the truth. It is a rigged freaking system, and the last time that I read an article on this, America is no longer a democracy, it is an oligarchy. It means that there is power in the hands of a very rich few, and that has been allowed to help, thank you, Supreme Court, and saying that corporations are people. They're so cute when they're young. Little babies, you kind of butter their little bottoms. You know, little baby corporations, adorable. Gotta say it. Once again, you are the largest generation coming through the pike. The power is yours to take. And I mean that sincerely. And clearly, we're not making particularly good judgments. You want worthy leaders, and you want something. When you truly decide you want something, the whole country will get it. Because you will have the longest time to change the course of things, and you are in the largest numbers. You are in the position that baby boomers were in the 70s when we moved a whole bunch of things, just not freaking far enough. Some things never change. I will do it in my own time when I'm ready, not before. I have two wonderful Gen Y children who never turned in their homework, not once. And in fact, they did their homework, but then they wouldn't turn it in. And I say, why wouldn't you turn it in? And they would say, they're just judging me, Mom. I don't feel like I need to do it. Well, yeah, that's called grading, sweetheart. They both are doing fine. But that little kind of like, you know, take this little quiz, take that little thing, they didn't feel the need to do it. In their minds, if I understand it, I understand it. I don't need to kind of keep doing busy work so you know I understand it. Your generation is the best generation. When you want to know something, you go up onto the internet, you find what you need to know, and you learn it, right? You teach yourself programming and history and whatever it is, because when you finally want to know it, you will dive into it and you will learn it. But until then, all of the doesn't move you at all. You are optimistic realists, and you want better, but you agree the game is rigged. And that's part of the reason why Bernie is so attractive as an en masse to Gen Y. You have skills, as a generation that most of us don't expect. And one of my favorite things to say is, boomers, we grew up writing because that was the tool that we had, right? Wires, you grew up editing. You grew up shooting video. You grew up making collages. You know the first time I had to make a collage? We had to get like plastic paper and put it on a magazine and then put it in water. And I know you're going, what the hell are you talking about? Yeah, it's old caca and you don't need to know, but just say it was ugly and that's what we had. You can edit, you can make music, you have all sorts of tools we didn't have, but here's the problem. Because we were taught to write first, that's the medium we value, and we don't value your medium the way we should. So if there's any lesson you could possibly teach your boomer and Xer teachers, it would be this, that we all have communication tools and yours are not the paper and pen that ours were, right? And maybe they'll get it, because that's a critical piece. Your expectations, well, service expectations for Gen Y is note that I am not a freaking kid and I am capable. And in fact, Gen Y has seen more things in their lives than many of us have seen in most of ours, simply because of the exposure level that they see on the internet, right? They also want things fast. They want education fast. They want learning fast. Fast, fast, fast is kind of the way of the world. Violate their expectations, they will leave, they will take their friends, they will unfriend you on Facebook and tweet that you suck. Sound right? Classroom expectations, they want stuff relevant to the world, clear instructions and ongoing feedback. This is a group, when I used to teach at the university, I would like give the test at 10, right? And at 11, I'd get my first email. Do you have our grades yet? How about now? How about now? How about now? And when they would do a homework, it would be like, how was that homework? Tell me what I'm doing. Of all the things they hate, it's like that sense of being in the dark hole of I've done all this work and I don't know where I am in this. It's like, and we go, well, don't worry, I'll get your grades back to you next week. And they're like, I hate you. I hate you forever. Freaking give me my grades now. They also want team projects and fast fail. They like to work with others. It makes many hands make light work. It's really a fun thing. And we've not really gotten used to doing that a lot in our schools. However, fast fail is something unique to you, right? Which is, let me take a test, see if I know this stuff. And if I do, great, I don't have to take your class. And if I don't, okay, I guess I'll take the class. But they want to know where you are. It's like, do not make me sit in there where I'm sitting there, I'm listening to you talk, going, I know this, and I know that too. And I know that, and I know that. Is anybody on Facebook or Instagram? Oh my God, make it stop. That's how they feel when they feel like they know their stuff, and because of our rules, they feel like they have to take stuff over again. They like extra credit to bring grades up, and I do that all the time. I would say to folks, you know what? Okay, here's my class. At the end of it, if you're getting a grade you don't want, I'm perfectly willing to give you extra credit to bring your grade up, and I will happily grade it, because the truth is, you will work twice as hard to bring it up as you would have if you'd just done it right in the first place. And in my heart, I feel I'm teaching you a lesson.